Thank you, Dr. Salki. Thank you very much for your kind invitation to talk on behalf of ES. I want to say that really I feel a little unable to make a comprehensive summary of colorectal surgery in just 15 minutes. And maybe I had to make a slight change looking to the colorectal surgery by another way, that is looking what we have learned from large databases in relation to this kind of surgery. I think that is a quite new concept, and I hope that could be interesting for you. This is nothing to disclose, and also I want to say that I'm not expert on informatics. Then if there is any conceptual error, please, I apologize for that. Probably, I don't know if these are three videos that to show, probably yesterday in the IFSS dinner, we celebrate 30 years of endoscopic surgery. And I absolutely agree with Professor Cuccieri's statement that probably has been one of the most important changes in the practice of general surgery during the last 50 years. I want to say that this study has been very quickly from the beginning with Wickham, that was the urologist, that was the first that commented about minimally invasive surgery, to up to now. And we consider that, I remember Dr. Sataba here in these congresses that usually say, this is not a technological revolution, this is just a digital revolution. I didn't understand very well that, but now I think that we really understand that probably minimally invasive surgery is just a part of a gigantic evolution on the digital, on the digital world. Just here to show to you, approximately at this moment, 94% of all the information are stored in digital systems. That means that there are nothing in paper. All is inside a computer. And really, you can see this is several big data, but you can see the millions of data that you have in Facebook. And you can realize also the question that has been with Facebook and the release of information, because the amount of information is gigantic. I'd like to show very, very, very briefly what the means, the potential means of big data on healthcare to evaluate really in relation to minimally invasive colorectal surgery and also to some aspects of prospective in the future related to these aspects. Big data, when we talk about big data, we talk about the data sets that they are too large or too complex to be evaluated by conventional information, and we need special instruments to evaluate this kind of information. But just also some figures, this is the amount of information that we have. You can see here 1 billion of smartphones that you can understand very easily that the amount of information that 1 billion of phones will create. And this is, I don't know exactly how many zeros you will have here, is 25 million petabytes. That is really a big unit. Probably something that you need to take in account, and I think is very interesting, is Internet of Things, because every step that you make during the day, there is creating data. This data may be stored, and more important than that, this data may be processed. And obviously, there is a big market around that, because the stakeholder of big data, the patients, providers, researchers, pharma companies, medical device companies, payers, that means that there is a big business around that, because they create a lot of information. This is a figure coming from the Nature, in the Nature Reviews Cardiology, that if you change, you use the same device, the same schema, but you put here surgery instead cardiology, why not? Because you can get a lot of information coming from our patients and from hospitals, can be analyzed, and I try to show later, we can have a lot of new information. And also, this has had a big advantage. At the end, probably the impact when you get this information and you proceed, you can save, you can spare about, it's considered the United States, $300 billion of dollars. My personal opinion is that big data is at the level is a big iceberg with artificial intelligence, machine learning. I will talk just of the maybe something that we can is very easily to arrive, that is large databases, but I'm convinced that this iceberg will rise up, and in the next years we'll have a lot of information related to all these topics. Well, if we move really to evidence-based medicine and minimally invasive colorectal surgery, I want to say that many people complain that minimal invasive surgery is not really based in evidence-based medicine. To make prospective randomized trial is very difficult. Color 2 trial lasts more than 10 years. And there is some indication, like some adrenal achillesis spleen, that really we don't have evidence-based medicine, prospective randomized trials. Probably we can need additional tools to really discover or really confirm that this kind of surgery is interesting. This is a very nice paper in British Journal of Surgery analyzing the rise of big clinical databases. And there is a big number of databases. Probably we will focus on this one. I think it's a wonderful project for the American College of Surgery and the National Quality Program. And when we talk about databases, you say, okay, we have the administrative databases. That is rubbish. That really doesn't work. Just merely for administrative purposes. But there is, we talk about clinical databases that may be basic diseases or treatment bases like Nisqually. But obviously, databases have several problems. First of all, the data quality. To be useful, a database, you should cover all the population, should have all the variables, and also the interpretation should be risk-adjusted and propensity score. If not, you are comparing apples with peers, and you need to compare really the same type of patients. For what can be interesting this kind of large databases? Well, you can have, by example, an overview of the population, treatment process, and outcomes. You can identify risk factor and developing risk prediction models. This is the big data analytics. You can see also comparing outcomes between interventions and also assessing variations in healthcare. Just a very few examples. This is Denmark. It's a small country, 4 million people. But here, there is all the gallbladders operated in a country. And you can see that valdactyl injury is less than formal in the open way, in open time, and the factor to valdactyl injury is open surgery. This, you can see that in the real world, the real figure is at this moment cholecystectomy is safe, and the valdactyl injury maybe is overcome. You have also example another model. This is a French model with more than 50,000. Gastric bands, and you can see that 20% need to be removal, and need to be removal in 7 years, and here you have the analysis which were the main reasons by which this kind of procedure failed, and then probably that permit to say it doesn't work. Or a very recent combined, you can see here an analysis of 200,000 sleeve gastrectomies in which there is this kind of paper broke a number of affirmations that had been based in smaller trials. And also, maybe there is only few women here, but that's true. It seems when women operate, the patient go better and the mortality is lower. We need to investigate, and maybe sometimes some information is not very comfortable for us. We need to check. Well, if we look really for the core of this presentation, it was based in the NESQIP. The NESQIP is an American program that at this, is a program that began in 1991, that in 2004 they had more than 1,200,000 surgical procedure. In you checking the PubMed, looking for NESQIP and laparoscopic bariatric surgery on laparoscopic colorectal, we found 47 papers. We present the summary of a paper recently published that is published in the International Journal of Colorectal Disease that was just to know which was the outcome coming from these big large numbers. It was a meta-analysis, a structural meta-analysis looking for this kind of words. We found 59 papers, and from these 59 papers, we used 28 for the final analysis. And what we found? We found that there were papers that had interest in comparing different surgical techniques, lab versus open, lab versus robot, also in inflammatory bowel disease, also something that you will see later, that we can get better information for topics that usually you need a huge number of patients in every part of a prospecting randomized trial that you need to check, by example, in the real world to know exactly what happened, and also the disparities according to sociodemographic features. I consider that these two papers in 2007 summarized perfectly that inside, based in evidence-based medicine, colorectal surgery had advantages in a short term and in a longer term. Okay, this is over. But here you can understand that it's a very selected group of patients inside prospecting randomized surgeries. We need some kind of external validation. And this paper, very nice, maybe just at the beginning, but you can see here the figures. You can see that real in the real world, all the data that we get from prospecting randomized trial really was true. It was considered external validation because you can see that the patient, the mortality, morbidity, et cetera, was absolutely lower inside this group of patients. Another information coming also with a big number of patients is comparing unfrequent situations, by example, colectomy, total colectomy or subtotal colectomy, and we can found that was a similar mortality rates, higher complications in the lab group with a shorter stay. And probably this kind of trial could be done in evidence-based medicine surgery. Also, by example here, comparing APR, abdominal perineal resection, comparing more than 1,000 patients, and also showing the advantages, also the advantages of lab surgery over conventional, over open surgery. However, here there is a shortcoming because in these databases we don't have access to the pathological specimen. That means that probably we have some risk because it's only clinical. Also, here you know that there is a big concern in relation to rectal cancer. And you can see here also when you compare in this real world. You can see also the results are very similar to the Color 2, to the Korean, and all the trials that has been performed up to now to show that rectal laparoscopic surgery is better than conventional open one. One of the most probably conflicting aspects is the robot. I know that here in the United States is well established. In Europe, there is a problem. And there is only one paper that is Lollar that could demonstrate that it's better than conventional lab surgery, especially for rectal surgery. But when you look to the NESCIP, there is five papers comparing robotic-assisted surgery between colorectal and lab surgery. And you can go to the results. Most of them is well known that really it offers more time. It offers very few clinical differences and much more expensive. Probably in this country, there is another issues that favor the approach by rectal, by robot. There is also a subset of patients that well served by robot approach, but at least in Europe, this is a matter of controversy when the robot is so expensive. And you can see here that really there is not conclusive data that permit to say that is absolutely better except the comfort of the patient, of the surgeon when he's operating. Also, money also in this trial, by example, looking for this big number of patients, also we found that colorectal surgery is cheaper than you compare with a conventional open surgery. There is also, we know very quickly, but I would like to highlight some data that is in relation to some other aspects. By example, conversion, you can see here how it has, you can predict and you can know exactly which patient has much more risk to be converted. And also, you can see here that in this real world, when we try to make, we try to have comparable groups, the risk of leak is lower in laparoscopic surgery than in open surgery. And that in the univariate analysis, you see that laparoscopy reduced the risk for leak after surgery. This is also the need for reoperation is very, very similar. And the risk of readmission also can be predicted. But I would like just to something much more important. Look at this figure in a very important journal and looking for this amount of more of this. Really, laparoscopy is a predictor of decrease of mortality. That means that in a real world, when we compare this volume of patients, the mortality is much lower when the patient is operated by lab than when it's operated by open. Also, and a striking finding, by example, that also in the group of obese patients, laparoscopic colectomy reduced morbidity, and comparing an amount of 30,000 patients, and you can see that laparoscopy has an independently decreased all these kind of surgical complications when you operate obese patients by lab compared with open surgery. Something that has been striking that probably is in the mind of all of us is the infection, and you can see also that the infection rate is much lower. In our unit, we have a 2% of one infection after laparoscopic surgery. And also something that is very difficult to analyze in a conventional prospective randomized trial is, by example, the thromboembolism in colorectal surgery. And also you can see that after lab surgery, the incidence is lower, as also the pulmonary embolism that also is reduced when we operate the patient with lab approach. And probably you remember that when you operated the left colon, many, many times the spleen went to the bin, because it's quite infrequent to make an splenectomy in laparoscopic surgery. And only you can see in his 93,000 patients, there is only 215 patients with incidental splenic fracture. That is a predictor of a big important amount of complications. That means that try to avoid to take out the spleen when you're mobilizing the splenic fracture. Finally, also I think that is much more local, it's much more American, but also we can say that you can check if really this kind of surgery arrives to all the components of the society. That means to the race doesn't affect the selection, but it will depend of your income, if you have a private insurance, and to get access to laparoscopic surgery or to open surgery currently. That permitted to conclude that, my opinion, large database offers a complementary useful information that we considered like an external validation on those situations that evidence-based medicine is lacking. And also you can analyze infrequent situations that it cannot permit a prospective randomized trial. You can have more information, and I think that this kind of evaluation should be very interesting to control and to check the data coming from prospective randomized trial. But and this is a very provocative statement. Prospective randomized trial are really necessary. Here is Dr. Fingerhut, and maybe he was seized by this question. The really large big data may replace prospective randomized trial. There is some people that in academic settings say that, why not? Obviously, it's something that is much more difficult to answer. But let me just to continue with two or three slides. And please look to this slide that comes from this paper. And in the past, the surgeon was on the operating table with some instruments. Currently, we have much more information. You have information of the patient. There is some data from the patient. But look to the future, and there is really a big, enormous network, because you know, by example, the genome of the patient. You know exactly the current situation of the patient. You know all of that could be analyzed, and probably you can make a precision surgery. You can know if a patient in the operating table will leak and you will need to perform a hormone, or really if this patient don't need to be operated because the risk of this is so high. I don't know, maybe I'm wondering, but I think that the future looks in this way. Obviously, these new operating rooms, this is, by example, a picture that I take in a conference of Dr. Organ. That is the new capabilities of the robot, in which the robot includes all this information that it occurs during the procedure. That now, at this moment in Europe, there is a consortium of different enterprises just to look exactly to analyze what happened inside an operating room. And obviously, in this operating room, you can when you will ask about needle navigation, perfusion monitoring, etc., you can get all this information can come to you, and much more easier. You can see here that for a simple cholecystectomy, you can get all this kind of information during or before the operation. This is information that may help to you to make a safer procedure. And this is, by example, a meeting that was in Germany 1 year ago, in which you can see here surgical data science, computational challenge, and future opportunities. And thank you very much for your attention. I want to say that I consider that large databases are only the tip of the iceberg in the potential application of big data technology and analytics in minimal invasive surgery. And as surgeons with a very important, very technological environment, probably we need to lead the movement and to need to get the information and to know which information that can be later applied for ourselves in our operating room when we are operating. Thank you very much for your attention.